Tonight is a night where actually you get to have your cake and eat it too. So yes, there will be cake. Yes, you get to eat it and it will be fun. But with all of that, I'm going to turn the Zoom mic over to my dear friend and colleague, our distinguished visiting professor, Dr. Tim Chartier.
Great, thank you. It's wonderful to be able to introduce my colleague and friend, Deanna Haunsperger. So tonight we will indulge in a mathematical journey with Dr. Deanna Haunsperger. Be prepared that you may never split dessert the same again. And I was at the 4 o'clock, and that is definitely the case. I have some math to teach my family. Deanna is a professor of mathematics at Carleton College in Minnesota, where I've been told they will have snow until May. Since her own undergraduate days, Deanna has been interested in increasing the number and diversity of students who pursue advanced degrees in mathematics. That passion guided her as a former co-editor for Math Horizons, the Mathematical Association of America's magazine for undergraduates. From 1995 to 2014, she co-founded and co-directed with her fellow mathematician and her husband, Steve Kennedy, who's here, Carleton's Summer Mathematics Program for Women, an American Mathematical Society's program that makes a difference, an intensive 4-week summer program designed to encourage undergraduate women to pursue advanced degrees in the mathematical sciences. From the 343 women who joined the summer program's community as undergraduates, 131 now hold a PhD in mathematical science. 11 more hold a PhD in a cognate discipline, and 80 hold terminal master's degrees in mathematics. That is, about two-thirds of the students who joined that program as undergraduates now hold advanced degrees in mathematics. Deanna has also chaired the Mathematical Association of America's, known as the MAA's, Strategic Planning Committee on Students and the Council on Outreach, and she recently served as president of the MAA. Currently, Deanna is the editor of the MAA's blog site, Math Values. And that brings us to tonight. As an applied mathematician, I must say that cake cutting is about as applied as it can be, particularly in my household. So let's get into the main dish for tonight and welcome Dr. Deanna Haunsperger to the Mo Math stage.
Great, thank you so much. I really appreciate you coming out on such a beautiful day. It's nice to be here doing math with you. This is a topic that has been of interest to me since, for anyone who has children or ever was a child. I have a couple children of my own, and at Sam's first birthday, well, it wasn't his first birthday, it was like his fourth birthday cake, I made a car, and you can see him and Tim trying, his best friend Tim, trying to decide how exactly they're going to split up this car fairly, or maybe they weren't worried about fairly. But how would they, with the two of them, how do you divide a cake so that it's fair between the two of you?
Cut it across a line of symmetry.
Oh, that's right. Unfortunately, you can see my cake. It's not terribly symmetric. Maybe there's some way, but if it's not at all symmetric, what do we do? Yes.
So there's this famous episode in Genesis. Abraham and Lot have to split up some land. So Abraham says, okay, I'll make the line, the border. You pick which side you want.
Yes, thank you very much. All parents know this practice. I cut, you choose, especially if you have two kids. So they can divide. Sam will make one. It doesn't matter which one. Sam makes a cut and says, this is my half, or this is half, and this is half, and then Tim chooses. And Tim, of course, will be able to pick whichever one he thinks is at least half. So then both kids will be happy. Both kids will have at least half of the cake. Okay, so suppose they play I cut, you choose on this cake. And this literally happened with us. And Sam was really interested in the letter S. He wanted the letter S because he knew it was the start of his name. So he put a lot of value on that. Now, when we're talking about cake cutting today, we're not talking about getting out a ruler and measuring, and we're not worried, you know, we want to be something more than symmetric cakes. So if you have a symmetric cake, I agree, you might want to cut down a line of symmetry. But let's just imagine today that our cakes are not symmetric, that there's a nice chocolate vanilla swirl, and I like chocolate, and some people like the icing and some people don't like the icing, so you might want the big flower of icing on there. They're not symmetric cakes, but you have different values. And so Sam really wanted that S. So we cut it so that he could have the S. And so let's say he cut it so that he could have the S. And then Tim got to choose. Well, Tim wanted more cake. So Tim took the big piece of cake with the S missing, and Sam had the S. And they were both very happy. Okay, the problem is Sam has a little sister. Her name's Maggie. So Maggie arrived, and they have to figure out now what to do to cut the cake so that it's fair again. So if we could have some cakes go out to the tables, and you have some knives and plates, and you're going to take a cake and unwrap a package, take one of the cakes and put it on a plate, and then you're going to play. Each table is going to have a Sam and a Tim and a Maggie. So assign the roles at your table. Who's Sam? Introduce yourselves, by the way. Introduce yourselves to each other. But then each table is going to have a Sam, a Tim, and a Maggie. And so Sam and Tim were going to fairly divide the cake and then figure out what you're going to do so that when Maggie comes, it's fair division as well, fairly divided. Go ahead and give it a try. You're imagining that these are not symmetric. Remember, you're imagining that this is not symmetric, that there are kids are cutting. We have a question over here, Tim.
Hold on. Do all three pieces have to be roughly equal, or does Sam still value the S more?
Oh, different kids might value it differently. So it's whatever that kid values. You know, he might like the S better. He might like the chocolate swirl better. I'd like to hear your thoughts on this. What do you have to suggest? We have a microphone over here. If you have comments, what would you like to suggest? Okay, well, let's think about this together a little bit then. So Sam and Tim played I Cut, You Choose. And when Maggie arrives, they could cut each of their pieces in front of them. Sam has this little piece that's just an S, and Tim has a large piece. But they could cut each one of their pieces into thirds. And then Maggie could take one of each of those thirds. So she could take one of the third pieces that's in front of Sam and one that's in front of Tim. Okay. Now, if she does that, is everyone happy? That's the question. So Maggie would have a third of the big piece that was in front of Tim. She has Earth Day Am. And she has a little bit of the S from Sam, from those cuts. Okay, first of all, we have to decide mathematically what it means to be happy. So what does it mean to be happy? Here, I'm going to tell you what it means to be happy, and we can discuss whether this is the right thing later. So we'll say that one of the three children sharing a cake is happy if they believe that they received at least a third of the cake in their value. Now, a third in my value, or a third in Sam's value. Okay, so let's see if the kids are happy with this choice. So after the first step, each boy believes that he got at least a half of the cake. All right, then each boy split their piece into thirds. After Maggie takes a piece from each boy, they each believe that they have at least two-thirds remaining, two-thirds of their one-half, so they have at least a third. So each boy believes he got at least a third. Now, what's Maggie think? The boys may have cut their pieces incorrectly. In fact, Maggie surely thinks that Sam cut his piece incorrectly because he got this little tiny piece that's just an S, and she doesn't care about the S. So she thinks that the boys cut theirs incorrectly, But she believes she received at least a third of each of their pieces because she got to pick whatever she thought was the biggest third that was sitting in front of them. And together, that's a third of Sam's piece and a third of Maggie or Tim's piece. So that's a third of Sam and Tim's piece together. But that's a third of the whole cake. That one there represents the whole cake. So that's a third. So she believes that she got at least a third. Questions about that? We agree?
What's the algorithm for the three people again?
Yes, so Sam...
The first person cuts?
The two of them, Sam and Tim, are going to, I cut, you choose. So they cut it. One of them cuts it. The second person chooses. Then when Maggie arrives, each boy cuts the piece in front of him into thirds. And Maggie takes a third of Sam's and a third of Tim's.
Thank you.
Okay. The problem is Tim has a little sister too. So Kim arrives, and now what do they do? So you have this cake in front of you that you fairly divided amongst three people. Now share it with Kim too so that they each feel like they get a fair share. So you can open up the other cake if you want and try it again, but try it. There's a Sam, a Tim, Maggie and a Kim in your table. You can go from where you are, or if, say, you've eaten part of the cake so far, you could then start over with the fresh cake. But give it a try.
So there's a question here.
Yes.
So do we start with the cake as you cut it, so we should cut it up into thirds, I mean, into halves, and each of the halves into thirds, and that's the starting point now?
You would cut it into thirds after Maggie arrives, and then now when Kimmy arrives, you're going to have to take each of those pieces and cut it up some more.
So we're starting from this highly fragmented cake already.
Okay, let's come back together and talk about this. Did it work? Can you generalize this? What did you think? Tim, can we have a mic over here? I want to hear what he has to say.
Yes. Give me 1 second.
Yeah. Yeah, did it work?
Sort of. So you can just keep doing the same thing. You could cut each piece into fourths and then have Kim take one quarter or one of the fourths from every single piece.
Yes.
But the cake crumbles to dust as you do so. If a fifth person shows up, we're done for.
A fifth person showed up. Perfect timing. Yes. You can keep doing the same thing. So we could take and cut each of the pieces in front of Sam, Tim, and Maggie into fourths. And then Kim gets to take one of each of those fourths. Everyone should still be satisfied. Sam, Tim, and Maggie each keeps 3/4 of their piece, which they believe is at least a third. So therefore, they have at least a fourth of the cake. Now, again, Kim might believe that the other three didn't have any idea what they were doing when they cut their pieces before, but she now gets to choose the biggest fourth of each of their pieces, so she ends up with a fourth of the whole cake. Okay, this does work for any N. It generalizes. As a fifth person comes in, we can do this again. What's the problem? The problem is it's a crummy solution. So how many cuts do we have to make? Now, this is a worst-case scenario, how many cuts do we have to make. But when it's just two people, it's I cut, you choose. When it's three people, let's think about this. So Sam and Tim played I cut, you choose. That was one cut. Then in front of each of them is a piece of cake, and they need to cut it into thirds, so they each need to make two cuts. So that's four more cuts, or a total of five cuts. Now there are pieces in front of Sam and Tim and Maggie, and they have to cut each one of those into fourths for Kim. They have to make 18 cuts to do that. At worst, they have to make 18 cuts to do that. So that's a total of 23 cuts. This number goes up really fast, and you may recognize those 1, 5, 23, 119, or if you add 1 to each of those, 2, 6, 24, 120, you might recognize those. Those are factorials. Those are factorials. So these are numbers are factorial minus 1. Very good. Can we use fewer cuts? We hope so, because we don't want to destroy the cake. So this is sort of our goal right now, is to think about how we can use fewer cuts. Let me talk about our assumptions that we're using as we make this. So everyone, I'm assuming, has a continuous value function. So that is, they value the cake, we'll call it 100% or 1. So the whole cake is worth 1. And then if I cut the cake into two pieces, piece 1 and piece 2, my value for this piece and my value for this piece added together is also 1. It's going to be the sum of the values of the two pieces. That is, if I were to cut two pieces of cake, you would value those two pieces separately the same as you would value them if they were still stuck together. Now, this isn't true for everything, and I always remember to say this because P union P looks like pup, and it's not true for puppies. You can't cut puppies in half and have the two halves to separately value the same as the whole puppy together. So there are some things that are divisible and some things that aren't divisible, and we're going to work with just divisible things like cake and land. So the cake doesn't lose value if divided. Also, if given an instruction like cut that piece of cake into 4 equal pieces, a player can do so. So there was a question earlier, are we talking about kids or are we talking about parents? Well, we're having fun talking about kids, but it might need to be someone a little bit older who is able to cut things into equal pieces. If a player fails to comply with such an instruction, then theirs is the fair share that may be compromised. Like if Sam and Tim, when they originally were playing I Cut, You Choose, if Sam's trying to get the bigger piece and maybe he didn't care about the S and he cuts 3/4 of the cake, well, Tim then can choose that 3/4 of the cake. So Sam's the one who loses out if he tries to game the system and cut a bigger piece than his share. Okay, so we're going to, yes, there's a question.
Does that also cover conspiring? Like if Sam and Tim are somehow colluding and maybe answering incorrectly to try to get Maggie less cake, is that covered by this bullet as
no,
well?
No, no. I mean, it wouldn't matter with two players, but with more players, no, they could conspire against their sister Maggie, and of course they would. But we're not going to talk about that today. They're going to be nice kids today. Okay, so we want to go back to this idea of trying to minimize the number of cuts. So let's just try another method. Let's try this method of trimming, and if we could have some more cake around the tables. So what we're going to do is we're going to have, there are going to be 5 kids at each table. I know as soon as the cakes go around, everyone starts talking, but if you can just let me give you instructions first. There are 5 kids at each table, so number yourselves 1 to 5, and I want you to fairly divide this cake. And so here's what you're going to do. I'm just going to talk you through it once. So take half, I mean, the brownie kind of looks like it's in 2 pieces, so take 1 of those pieces and put it on a plate. Kid number 1 is going to take a knife and cut the brownie, cut a fifth of the brownie off. So kid number 1 should do that right now. Cut off a fifth of the brownie. Now, that kid number 1 is going to take that fifth of a brownie and pass it to kid number 2. And I'm just going to give you instructions for this, and then you can play with it a little more on your own. Kid number 2 is going to look at that brownie piece and decide whether it's greater than a fifth or if it's smaller than a fifth. If it's smaller, pass it on. We're going to assume that kid number 2 thinks it's smaller. So go ahead and pass it on to the next person in line. Okay, kid number 3, are we all up to kid number 3?
No.
Okay. So kid number 1 is to cut a fifth of the cake. Is that done? Okay, kid number two is supposed to consider the cake, but I'm just telling you, kid number 2 in this situation thinks that it's smaller than a fifth. I'm just going to tell you kid number 2's opinion, smaller than a fifth. So they pass it on to kid number three.
The whole thing or just
the fifth piece, the small piece. Okay. Kid number three in this situation is going to say, no, 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 that's bigger than a fifth. So kid number three has a job. Kid number three is going to trim that piece down to a fifth, take the trimmings, and stick it back on the original cake. So kid number three is going to trim it down to a fifth of the cake, take the trimmings and put them back, smoosh them back onto the original part of the cake, the original four-fifths, so that it's all one big four-fifths of a cake again. Yes. So kid, I'm just having you walk through a scenario. So kid one cuts a fifth off of the cake, and then the four-fifths get set aside and passes it to kid two. Kid two thinks, is this a fifth of the cake? No, it's not a fifth of the cake. So I'm going to pass it on to kid three because I don't want it. Okay, now kid three is going to look at it. And kid three in this case says, oh, wait, this is more than a fifth of the cake in this scenario. So kid three is going to trim it down until it is a fifth of the cake and put the trimmings back onto the four-fifths. Okay? Are we everyone done with kid three? Okay. Kid four is going to look at that and say, that's not a fifth of the cake. And kid five is going to look at that and say, that's not a fifth of the cake. And they're going to feel ripped off. So that cake gets passed back, that piece gets passed back to kid three, who did the trimming. That person, does that person have the cake now? Okay, that person takes that piece of cake, stands up from the table, literally, stand up from the table, and you can eat it, yes. And you can eat it. But you don't get to sit back down yet. You have to stay because you're not playing anymore. Now there are four kids at the table and four-fifths of the cake left. And the people at the table believe it's at least four-fifths. Why? Talk to your neighbors. Talk to your neighbors about why does everyone seated believe that it's at least four-fifths of the cake still? Yeah, I'd like to hear your opinion over here.
Person one believes that that one-fifth was one-fifth, so they believe that the rest of it is four-fifths. Person two, four, and five each individually believe that that one-fifth was less than one-fifth, so they believe that the rest of the cake is more than four-fifths.
Exactly. Exactly. So now you have at least four-fifths of the cake left, at least four-fifths, and there are four of you. So you can do the exact same thing. Okay. Think about that. Let digest that for a second and digest the little bit of cake that you're allowed to eat. So now you have four people. So the person who is standing or should be standing is no longer playing. You're out. You have your cake. You can now sit down. And the four-fifths, the four people who are still playing, you are trimming the four-fifths of the cake remaining. And go ahead and try that. Okay, let's come back together. Are there any questions about what you're seeing, that it works? Okay, if you're not the last person and you think the piece is more than one-nth, you have to cut a piece off. You have to cut it down. Because why? Somebody else could end up taking it, and then you're going to be left with less than four-fifths of the cake or less than three-fourths of the cake. You won't be left with enough. You won't be happy the next time around. All right, how many cuts did it take? Well, let's see. When we start with five kids, how many people cut the cake? It could be kid one, two, three, and four could all cut the cake. The fifth one never would, because the fifth one gets it. And if the fifth one thinks it's more than a fifth, they're happy, and they just take the piece and walk away. But so with five kids, it's at most four. And then when you're down to four kids, it's at most three cuts. And then when you're down to three kids, it's at most two cuts. So what do you have? You are going to have four cuts, three cuts, two cuts, one cut. So let's talk about that. So with two kids, it's just I cut, you choose, or one cut. With three kids, it's two and then one cut, or three total. With four kids, well, with four kids, you're going to have three cuts, and then it's down to three kids. But we already know that that's six cuts. So it's six plus four, or 10. You might recognize these numbers. The next time, it's going to be 10 plus 5, or 15. And look how much smaller that is. Look how many fewer cakes. That's actually edible kinds of cake then. So if you have 10 kids, it's 45 cuts instead of 3,628,799. This is an improvement. How do we minimize the number of cuts now? Yes, there's a...
So mathematics aside, it seems like psychologically, the one with lots of cuts, we were like trying to be like as fair as possible. You know, we were just trying to be fair,
mm-hmm.
and very simple and fair. But the ones when we actually reduced the cuts, it felt like we were being like clever and like trying to like compete with each other and outsmart each other and want to make sure that nobody got a bigger piece if I wasn't going to get a bigger piece. And it seemed very like, you know, devious, you know, and yet it reduced in smaller cuts. And I'm just curious about that psychological aspect that led to a different mathematical solution.
Yeah, we're going to talk about more of that psychological aspect in just a moment, if you can just hold that thought. Okay. All right, so how do we minimize the number of cuts? Well, let's say we're having five kids divide up a cake, and they each need their own piece. How many cuts do we have to make to divide a cake so that five people can share it? Four. You're going to have to make at least four. Let's see if we can do this fairly so that everyone is happy, as we defined happy before, using a minimal number of cuts. So what we're going to do is we have this big cake here, and I want to take a big knife, and I'm going to move, starting at the left-hand edge, I am going to move this knife across the cake. Could you be my kids for this example, please? So you five are going to watch this knife moving across from left to right. And as soon as you see that there's at least a fifth of the cake on the left, so that you believe that, whichever of you believes that first is going to yell, cut, okay? And you get that piece. So I'm going to move this knife from the left, and you, okay. And I'm going to cut the cake right here, and the first person who yelled cut first, all right, wonderful, you get the cake to the left. Now, you yelled cut first, which means the other four of you weren't first to yell it. So the other four of you think, what about the rest of the cake? It's at least four-fifths remaining, because you didn't yell cut, so you didn't think there was a fifth to the left. So you think there's at least four-fifths remaining. So now the person who yelled cut is going to take the piece to the left and walk away and go eat it. And the four of you play the same game with the smaller piece, with the four-fifths that are remaining. But you're happy because she thinks she got at least a fifth of the cake, a fifth of the cake and walked away. You think there's at least four-fifths remaining, so you can play this game again and you'll get your fair share. Does that make sense? Yeah, and we only needed four cuts to do it. Okay. I just played that with five kids. Okay. So how many cuts is the best possible? And this generalizes easily. I just played that with five people, but on my slide it's for four. Okay, what's the problem with this? Did you have any problem when you were playing this? No, but I think if you were smaller, if you were a younger child, you might, because you have to make that decision constantly. You have to be continuously making that decision. It's a continuous thing. So you have to continuously be looking at where the knife is and deciding, is that a fifth? Is that a fifth? Is that a fifth? And making that decision continuously can be a difficult thing. So how can we minimize the number of cuts without using a moving knife? So let's think about this. So I want to minimize the number of cuts again, but I don't want to have moving knives. I want to have a decision so that you can think about it, so that you can think about the different sizes of the pieces. So we're going to play this for four kids and no moving knife. So here's my cake. And again, we're thinking of cakes that aren't all uniform in size, even though my picture up here is fairly uniform. Think about it with chocolate swirls and M&Ms in one corner and a flower in another corner. So different people might want different things. Okay, so the four people, A, B, C, and D, are going to hold their knives parallel to each other at the midpoint of the cake. So they're going to decide what's the middle of the cake, and they're going to hold their knives parallel to each other at that midpoint. Now, I have the midpoint spread out here just so you could see. I imagine that the knives would be much closer together if you were actually doing this, but here I just have them spread out so that we could talk about them. Okay, so what's going to happen? The cake is going to be cut between the middle two knives. And then A and B are going to get, it's going to be cut right down here, and A and B are going to get the cake on this side. C and D are going to get the cake on the right. Okay, and then A and B are going to play I cut you choose on this left part, and C and D are going to play I cut you choose on the right part. All right, I want you to talk to your neighbors. And is this fair? Are they going to think this is fair in our current definition of fair? Okay, what do we think? Is this fair? Do the four? We have an opinion over here that it's not fair. I want to hear this.
How do you decide what's the midpoint between B and C?
Oh, I'm the mom, so I'm just going to make a cut between B and C.
Okay, then, yeah, it's fair.
Any cut I want between B and C. So, okay, if I make the cut, is it fair now if I make a cut between B and C? Well, let's look at it, okay? So if I cut between B and C, and A and B are going to share the piece to the left, I can make a cut anywhere I want between B and C. And now A and B are going to share the cake to the left. If I cut between B and C, A thinks that the green line is the midpoint of the cake. So they're going to be happy that they got way more than half of the cake to split. B thinks that the blue line is the midpoint of the cake, and they're going to be happy that they think they got way more than half of the cake. Now, A and B, do I cut you choose on more than half of the cake? So they're each going to get more than a quarter of the cake. So yeah, they're both happy. And for the exact same reason, C and D are both going to be happy. Does that make sense? Yes.
So mathematically speaking, what makes a person more happy, cutting or choosing?
I don't know, mathematically speaking, but I'm going to talk about your issue right now. What's the problem with this? The problem is this isn't how kids think. A six-year-old doesn't care about getting a fifth of the cake. They just want the biggest piece. They want to be able to look at all the pieces and say, I got the biggest one. Not, oh, this is a fifth of the cake. That's not how they think. That's not how he thinks either, I think. This is the issue of envy, and we need to figure out how to do this envy-free. So that's our goal. Is that this problem of envy, this each person may believe that they received an nth of the cake, but they believe that someone else may have gotten more. Okay, let's look back at the first methods we were looking at. We looked at successive pairs. That's where Sam and Maggie and Tim and Kim were sharing. We looked at trimming, where we had kids 1 through 5, and we were trimming it and passing it around. And then we looked at moving knife, where somebody yells cut and we cut and that person walks away. Okay, so let's look at each one of these thinking about envy. So with envy, it might be clearest instead of taking the S out that Sam may have wanted the exclamation point. So he may have been really happy with just taking that end piece of the cake and Tim got the big piece. And then each one of the boys splits their piece into thirds when Maggie arrives. And Maggie gets whatever she considers the biggest third in front of each of the boys. Okay, so is Maggie happy? Or does she envy someone? And she is a little sister, let me just say. So she envies someone. Yeah, what's your thought?
She could envy Tim. If she just cares about cake, then Tim has clearly more cake than her.
That's right. Tim clearly has more cake than her, and she, is being a little girl at the time, definitely wanted more cake. So she envies Tim. She thinks Sam cut it incorrectly to begin with, and that Tim got the biggest piece. So yes, as someone can envy someone else in successive pairs because they don't get to, Tim doesn't get any say in how Sam cuts it, or Sam doesn't get any say in how Tim cuts it. So they could envy each other. Okay, how about in the trimming one? Well, someone, kid three, was happy, took the piece and stood up. I made kid three stand up in here. Okay, but now when the next piece goes down the line, it could get to the last kid in the row, kid five, and kid three is like, hey, that piece is way bigger, but it's too bad. The one who already took the piece left and doesn't get any say in how the cutting goes afterwards. The same is true of moving knife. When I cut that knife and she took a piece and stepped away to go eat it, she doesn't have any say in what pieces other people get or how big their pieces are. So she could be envious of anyone who comes after her. Okay, so can we avoid envy? That's a huge area of mathematics, thinking about how we fairly divide things so that we can avoid envy. So here's a way to do it for three players, and then we'll try to generalize. So with three players, there's going to be a fourth person, say the mother, who is going to hold a sword. This is my sword. Maybe this is my sword. Okay, so the fourth person is going to hold a sword to the left, at the left edge of the cake, and start moving it slowly to the right. Meanwhile, the three kids who are playing, green, blue, and orange, are going to hold their knives at the midpoint of the cake to the right of the sword. So the sword is moving. They're going to have to be moving their knives as the sword is moving. The sword is slowly moving from left to right, and they're going to have to put their knives at the midpoint of the cake to the right of the sword. Okay, now what's going to happen? Anyone, green, blue, or orange, any of the three kids, can yell cut when they believe that they want the piece to the left of the sword. Okay, so when they think the sword has gone over more than a third of the cake, but they know everything that's going to happen. The three players, green, blue, and orange, they completely know this algorithm. So if they yell cut, they know exactly what's going to happen. Now I'm going to tell you exactly what's going to happen. A cut is made at the sword and the middle of the three knives. Okay, you're not going to yell cut unless you're going to be happy with the piece that everyone gets when the cut is made. You will just wait until something better comes along. So if someone yells cut, then they are not going to be envious of anyone else because they made that decision. They yell cut, they know what piece they're going to get. And no one else should be envious of them, of the person who yells cut, because if they wanted that piece, they should have yelled cut earlier. Okay, so let's try a scenario here. Let's suppose it was the orange player who yelled cut. Okay, orange is not going to be envious of whatever green and blue get because she knows what they're going to get. And green and blue aren't going to be envious of the piece that orange gets to the left of the sword because they know that and they didn't yell cut. All right, let's think about, would green or blue envy each other? So the cut is going to be made at blue. Blue thinks that the cake to the right of the sword, the midpoint is where the blue sword is. So blue thinks that his piece is exactly half of what's remaining, and blue thinks that that wasn't at least a third of the cake to the left of the sword. So blue must think there's at least two-thirds of the cake to the right of the sword, and blue gets half of it. And orange gets half of it. Green gets half of it. So it doesn't matter to blue. Blue's not envious of anyone. How about green? Green's not envious of orange. And green thinks that the green line is the halfway point on the right-hand side to the right of the sword. But green gets more than that, because green gets from the black sword to the blue line. So green gets more than what they think is the halfway point. So no one is envious of anyone else. Does that make sense? Or do you have questions about that? Okay. The hard part is trying to generalize this. So that's for three players. Now, is there an envy-free method for more than three players? So, yes, there is. But we are going to really work hard to get there. So bear with me on this one. We're going to need something called Austin's procedure. So Austin's procedure allows two people to split a cake so that each values their piece exactly in half. Exactly half. All right, how are they going to do that? Remember before when we did I Cut, You Choose, maybe Sam cut it so that he believed it was half, but Tim might think one of them was 3/4 and the other is 1/4, so he's going to take the bigger one. But this Austin's procedure allows two people to divide a cake so that they both completely agree that it's a half. Here's what's going to happen. So in Austin's procedure, one player takes two knives and holds the two knives, the black knives here, at what they believe there's half of the cake between them. Now, this same player is going to move these two knives slowly to the right, making sure that there's always half the cake exactly between them. Now, when he gets to the other side, when the right black knife gets to the other side, where's the left black knife going to be? Yeah, and where is that? Well, the right knife is going to be over here, so the left one is going to be right here, because he thought that was half, so he thinks this is half. So the left black knife will be where the right black knife started. Do you agree with that?
Sure.
Okay. So let's think about player two this whole time. Player two is looking at this, and player one is keeping half the cake between the knives at all time. Okay. What's player two thinking? Player two looks at the beginning and said, that's not half the cake. That's way less than half the cake between those two knives. But when player one gets to the right-hand side, what's player two think?
Has to think it's more,
because this was less than half. This must be more than half. Ooh, but I'm moving these knives continuously. So it was less than half, and it goes to more than half. What must have been somewhere in the middle? It has to be half. Yeah, there's a math theorem that tells us that, if we happen to know it. The intermediate value theorem says that since I'm doing this continuously and it goes from less than half to more than half, it has to go through half someplace. So player one is going to move the two knives from left to right, keeping half the cake between them at all times. Player two is just going to watch. And at some point, it must go through where player two also thinks that it's half. And at that point, she's going to yell, cut, and he'll drop the knives down. And one person gets the cake between the two knives, and the other person gets the cake outside the two knives, and each person will agree that it's exactly half the cake. Okay? All right. Stick with me here. We're going to do this. So we're going to do an envy-free method for four players. We just did envy-free for three. That was with the sword and the three knives. Now we're going to do envy-free for four. So Sam and Maggie are going to use this Austin's procedure three times to divide the cake into four pieces, each of which each kid values a fourth. So if they can divide, if Sam and Maggie can divide the cake in exactly half, then they can divide each half into exactly half. So they have, they end up with four pieces they each think is exactly one fourth. Okay. Now, Tim comes in and he's going to take the piece that he thinks is the largest and he's going to trim it down so that there's at least a two-way tie for the largest. And then the trimmings are set aside. Okay, so Tim comes in, he looks at the four pieces. Maybe he thinks they're all equal, but probably not. He thinks there's one that's the largest and one that's the second largest. He's going to take the one that's the largest and he's going to trim it down so that the top, that he has, there are two that are the same size to him, that are the top two. And the trimmings get set aside. Okay, now don't worry about the trimmings yet. Kim gets to come in and make her first choice. She can choose any of the four pieces she wants. Tim gets the second choice, but if Kim didn't take the trimmed piece, he has to. Okay, so let's think about this for a second. Kim got the first choice. She's not going to be envious of anyone. She got whatever she thinks is the biggest. Tim said there was a two-way tie for the biggest, so he has to take one of the trimmed piece. He has to take the trim piece if she didn't, so that he gets one of the two biggest pieces. Sam and Maggie thought they were all the same size, so that trim piece, they think that's smaller. So they're not going to be jealous of anyone. They're envious of anyone who got the trim piece. So after Kim and Tim decide, then Maggie and Sam choose. And no one's going to be envious of anyone. But we have to deal with the trimmings. We can't just brush them on the floor or whatever this table wanted to do over here. We have to deal with the trimmings now. Okay, so far it's envy-free. No kid envies anyone. But then there's this pile of trimmings. So here's what we're going to do with the trimmings. Notice Sam and Maggie will not envy the kid with the trimmed piece, regardless of who gets the trimmings. They don't care. If the kid with the trimmed piece got all the trimmings, they wouldn't be envious because that would just be what they considered a fourth of the cake. So they won't care about that. So there are two cases. The first case is Tim took the trimmed piece. Then Kim and Maggie are going to take the trimmings and use Austin's procedure again to cut it into four pieces that they both think are exactly the same size. All right, and then among the trimmed pieces, we're going to choose in this order. First, Tim. Okay, so Tim gets to choose first. He's not going to be envious of anyone. And Kim thinks that all the trimmings are all the same size, so she's not going to care what Tim takes. And Sam and Maggie don't care whether Tim takes any trimmings at all. They don't care. Okay, so nobody's going to envy Tim, and Tim doesn't envy anyone because he was first. Next, Sam. Sam gets to pick one of them. Well, Sam's not going to envy Tim. He gets to pick one. He's not going to envy anyone else. Okay, and then Kim and Maggie think they're all the same size. So they just get, each one of them get to take one of the remaining pieces. Cool. In the second case, looks exactly like the first, only Kim took the trimmed piece. But it's exactly the same thing. Now, Tim and Maggie cut the trimmings using Austin's procedure into four pieces that they totally agree are the same size. And then they choose among the four trimmed pieces in the order Kim, because she didn't get to cut the trimmings. So she gets to pick first, and then she took the trimmed piece. Nobody's going to be jealous of her. And she didn't get to cut the trimmings, but she gets to pick first, so she's not going to be jealous of anyone. And then Sam, because Sam doesn't care that Tim, if Kim took all the trimmings. And then Tim and Maggie. But Tim and Maggie, they cut the trimmings, so they agree that they're all one-fourth of the trim. So then it's all good. So, phew, nobody is envious of anyone. That's four players. Now for five players, it gets much more challenging. It's still this idea of trimming. You're going to have to trim some of these pieces and then deal with the trimmings. But you're going to have to build up these advantages. That's what happened. Sam and Maggie didn't care whether the kid with the trimmed piece got all the trimmings because they had this advantage over them, they thought. So you have to build up these advantages over and over. This method, this Brahms-Taylor-Zwicker method, generalizes, but it's been unbounded. By unbounded, we mean that it didn't have we didn't know in advance how many slices it was going to take. Okay, people have been trying to find a bounded technique for a very long time, over 50 years. Walter Stromquist, who had the idea of the moving knife, actually thought it couldn't be bounded, and he was going to spend his retirement working on proving that it couldn't be bounded. But in 2016, a pair of computer scientists found a method that is bounded, that they can tell how many cuts it's going to take. Now, before, we knew that NV-free cake cutting would take at least N squared cuts for N players. So if you have like five kids cutting a cake to be NV-free, it was going to take at least 25 cuts. But there was no at most. And now we have this at most. Aziz and McKenzie showed it's bounded for N players by N to the 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 N, with roughly the same number of cuts in the bound. And that was considered the biggest result in fair division in decades. Okay, that number, N to the 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 N, is really hard to wrap your mind around. Why is it so hard? Well, let's look at just something much simpler. 4 to the 4 to the 4 to the 4. Okay, if I take and count all the atoms that make up the universe, all the atomic particles in the universe, and for each atomic particle, I gave it its whole own universe where it has just as many atomic particles in it. And then I count all those atomic particles for all those universes. It would be smaller than 4 to the 4 to the 4 to the 4. But the number of cuts that you have to make, that we know as the upper bound of cuts that you have to make, for 10 kids, 10 to the 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 10, it's just unfathomably large. So there's a lot of room for improvement in an upper bound, and I'm going to leave that to you as homework. So my daughter Maggie, you've seen her, you've heard about her. She had her own plan for fair division when she was a kid. So her plan, here she is making her plan at her birthday, and she is devious. She does like making plans. I cut, I choose. And she had her forego the knife method. So thank you very much for having me. I really appreciated the time here.
All right, if there are any questions, yes.
Thanks a lot for doing this lecture. Like, I love the math of everyday things like this, so thank you very much.
Absolutely.
Quick question. I eat cake every day. So if we take all the trimmings, right, we throw in a blender, and we make a new cake, do we still have to worry about the upper bound question?
Oh, good question. Yes, there's still an upper bound question, right. Right, because you have to build up these advantages, these small little advantages in these trim pieces. The more players you have, the more turns you need to take and slicing of the cake that has to happen. Blending a cake, I hadn't heard that one before, though. That's a good one.
It's two questions.
This is awesome. Thank you. I was wondering if, like, the algorithms change a bit if the turns are, like, iterative, as it, like, you go, then I go, as opposed to like the moving knife at the same time, if that makes sense. Like if you can only move by a certain unit or something.
Yeah, there aren't as many small number of cuts, plans, algorithms, if you can't use a moving knife. And the moving knife was to help us minimize the number of cuts. But it has a complicating factor in that, you know, we have to make these continuous decisions.
Okay, you mentioned that, you said that five pieces could only be made by four cuts, but if you think of cuts as straight lines in the plane, you can actually get away with three and get, well, you can even get more than five pieces with three cuts. But this is, now we're going two-dimensional. So is there, do you know if there's any, has anyone thought about if you're just making straight cuts, are there fair ways to do that?
I do not know. I do not know about fair division where, with cuts like you're describing. No, good question.
All right, so we have some open questions.
Yes.
About cake. Thank you very much.
They have their homework too.
And you have your homework. All right. Thank you very much, and we'll see you at the next math encounters.